There's one question which has appeared in a couple of questions of some people. Okay. And it says here, what is the fiqh ruling of following the madhab in our day? It's a few people have asked this. And what do you do when one is presented a hadith is contrary to what the school of fiqh says? And what is the difference between mujtahid and muhaddith and his superior, etc.? These are very delicate questions that require lengthy detailed explanations. If you want more details, I've actually done full lectures on this. You can actually just go on YouTube. There's a lecture titled Why Follow Madhabs When We Have the Quran and Sunnah. It's like eight parts, I don't know if you've seen it. This is just audio. I've given a very lengthy, an hour and a 20-minute discussion on this topic and some other topics. But I'll just briefly summarize this. For a Muslim, the one who believes in Allah and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, basically obedience belongs only to Allah first and foremost. Ita'atullah. A Muslim is supposed to obey Allah. Why is he obeying the Messenger of Allah? It's because Allah has said, وَمَا أَتَاكُمَ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. You obey Allah, and you only obey the Messenger of Allah because he is a representative on behalf of Allah, he is a Rasulullah. He's conveying the message of Allah. So now we know a Muslim has to only obey Allah, his messenger. Quran and Sunnah. For a Muslim, it's following the Quran and Sunnah and nothing else. Every Muslim, I mean, you cannot follow the Torah and the Zabur and the Injil or the Bible. Right? I mean, for a Muslim, you have to follow the Quran and Sunnah. Without a shadow of doubt, there's no denying of the fact. You have to follow the Quran and Sunnah. Then the question comes, how do we follow the Quran and Sunnah? We as Muslims, we all have to follow the Quran and Sunnah. How do you follow the Quran and Sunnah? When we look at the Quran and the Hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are two types of rulings. There are so many verses in the Quran and Sunnah, so many verses in the Quran and so many Hadith that relate to just basic etiquettes and general advice, nasiha. Do you understand? They're not ayatul ahkam. They're not verses relating to law. Right? They're just general advices, nasiha, stories of the prophets of the earlier times. And in those things, you follow the Quran and you look at the hadith, you don't need to ask anyone anything. When it comes to law, ahkam, the verses of the law, again in the Quran and Sunnah, there's two types of verses regarding law. Some are very clear cut. Like Allah says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا zina. Do not come even close to zina. It's clear. Basic rules are قَطْعِيُّ الثُّبُوتُ وَقَطْعِيُّ الدَّلَالَةِ. Absolute, clear-cut, categorical. There's no doubt in it. There's no two interpretations in them. There's no contradiction between that verse and another verse. There's no contradiction between this verse and another hadith. There's no contradiction between this hadith and another hadith. Sometimes it's like 20 hadiths on the subject. It's not like that. It's clear-cut. Absolutely unambiguous, crystal clear. The prohibition of backbiting, prohibition of murder, fornication, interest, labor, and then like the obligation of the five-time prayers, and hajj, and these are some basic rules of Islam. In there, nobody has to follow, nobody must follow any school of thought. It's clear in the Quran and Sunnah. You don't say, you know what, zina is haram. Why? Because the shafi'i school states zina is haram. That's absurd, ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. You know, murdering someone is haram. You know it's haram, why? Because the Hanafi school states. You shouldn't even say that. There is no taqleed, the taqleed means to follow. There is no following. However, there is a large percentage of laws in the Quran and Sunnah that are not categorical, that are not clear-cut. They are contradictory amongst each other. There's different hadiths. There are many rules like that. Sometimes a verse of the Quran, Allah says in the Quran, وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتُ يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ ثَلَاثَةَ قُرُوءٍ. A woman, when she's divorced, she has to do the waiting period, عِدَّة. What's her waiting period? What's her عِدَّة? The Quran says three قُرُوء. What is قُرُوء? I pick up the dictionary. You know the dictionary in the Arabic language? Two meanings of قُرُوء. Absolutely clear in two meanings. Both are valid translations. One meaning of قُرُوء is menstrual period. The other meaning is that purity between two periods, between two menstrual cycles, the period of tahara, purity. What does Allah mean here? He could mean this, he could mean that. You have to study all the hadiths. There's like two hadith contradictions. One hadith says, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, La salata illa bi fatiha bil kitab. The one who does not recite Surah Al-Fatiha in his prayer is invalid. It's like you haven't prayed. But there's another hadith that says, a sound hadith, مَنْ كَانَ لَهُ إِمَامٌ فَقِرَاءَةُ الْإِمَامِ قِرَاءَةُ لَهُ. Somebody is reciting behind the imam, he's not supposed to recite Fatiha. Imam's recitation is enough for him. Do you act on this hadith or do you act on this hadith? This is just simple, just salah itself. There's 200 issues in which there's difference of opinion. This is all, remember I was telling you yesterday, this is all to do with worship generally. When the real rulings of not backbiting, of jealousy, of hatred, there's no difference. They are a clear cut. There's no follow. So in this second category of laws, where we want to follow the Quran and Sunnah, we're trying to follow the Quran and Sunnah, when there's only two options that you have. In the first category, what did we say? In the first category, we said there's no following anybody. But in the second category of laws, when things are not clear, there's numerous hadiths on the subject. Sometimes there's 30 hadiths on the subject. For a person to come to a conclusion, you don't just pick up one hadith and you just read it. Have you read the other 50 relating to the topic and checked every single transmission chain and looked at everything, all the usul and all the principles? It's a big job. Sometimes it takes like 2 months with one issue, what the conclusion is. The scholars, you know, they looked into one issue. Just, there are books written, you know, whether a person should raise his hands in prayer or not. There's a book that I read, 600 pages, with all the hadiths. Maybe it's different prints, 400, 600, something like that. Different hadiths and, you know, texts and asaneed and looking at it and looking at usul and looking at everything collectively. These are experts. And today, unfortunately, everyone's the expert except the experts. Everyone knows to be a professional barrister, solicitor. Nobody's going to say that, you know what, you know, I'll just become a doctor myself. I don't need to come to the University of Oslo and start. You know what? I know English. Right? I can read books on medical science. Don't just go to the library, pick up all the books on medical science and open the surgery and start operating on people. Would anyone allow you to do that? Of course not. You have to go through the necessary means. Everything in the world requires a deep, deep study research. The only thing that doesn't require is Islam. Islam is just an orphan thing, you know, it doesn't need anything. Anyone can become any kullu muhabba wa dab, like the Arabs say. Every Tom, Dick, and Harry can become the Sheikh and the Mujtahid today. It's a problem. So in this second category of laws, we only have two options. You know what the two options are? Two options. There is no third option, and you know Islam, you realize there's two options. One option, one choice that I have is that I think to myself, you know what, I know Arabic. Remember, knowing Arabic it doesn't make a person a scholar. It's just 1%. I know Arabic, I can read books, I can read the Quran, I can read the Hadith, I'll see the Hadith, you know. I think I'm quite, you know, good, and I have a bit of, you know, confidence in myself. Let me see myself. And what if I understand, I'll come to conclusion. That's one option. You have to use your ijtihad. So that's one option. That look, this is one issue. What should you do in this issue? This contradict. It's not clear cut. Remember, we're not talking about the clear cut rulings. We're talking about the ambiguous, non-clear laws of the Quran and Sunnah. One option someone has is that. The other option is the person thinks to himself, you know what? I've become a bit humble, I don't want to be deluded, I don't really trust myself, I'm not qualified enough. Rather than me following my brain, because everybody's doing taqleed is following, rather following my brain, right, I rather follow the brain of thousands of scholars over thousands of years, rather than following my own brain. I am number one, 1430 odd years away from the time of the Messenger of Allah. These thousands of scholars, they were from the Sahaba, Tabi'un, like Imam Hanifa was a Tabi'i, Imam Malik was just after the Tabi'i, Imam Shafi'i was a student of Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad was a student of Imam Shafi'i, Imam Muhammad ibn Hassan was a student of Imam Malik and Imam Abu Hanifa, and he was a teacher of Shafi'i, Shafi'i was a teacher of Ahmad, and Imam al-Awza'i, and Sufyan al-Thawri, and Sufyan ibn Uyayna, and Imam, all these great Mujtahid Imams, they started that time. And then it carried on. It's a full research investigation of hundreds of scholars over thousands of years. Number one, they were close to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khayr al-qurun, they were the Salaf. Right? They were the Salaf. For me, the mere fact, right? This is just a personal thing now. For me, the mere fact that we live in a time wherein there's so much fitna, trouble. You know, subhanAllah, I mean, I would, for me, any day of the week, if someone told me you want to follow someone today, or someone who was 150 years after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, someone qualified even today, I'm not talking about a non-righteous person, qualified person, without a shadow of doubt, I'll follow someone that time. But oh, the mere fact that someone today is driving down Oslo and sees a billboard with a 7-naked woman on a car and says underneath it, test drive it well. You know, the car of the woman, Allahu Akbar. But that mere fact that people, even the righteous pious, you know, this is one of the issues that the morality that we have fitna in this time, when people are seeing obscene and nudity, not intentionally, I'm not saying they're sinful, but the mere fact somebody lived in an area or in an era that was absolutely pure, where you would never in your life, these imams never even imagined any woman, or they never even mistakenly it's not sinful, even saw any part of the aura of someone of the opposite gender, it was impossible. In itself makes me far more confident in someone that time than someone here. Even though this person is not sinful, his pious and righteous, but just a mere fact. So number one is that they were very, very close to the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They had the expertise, and it was a research, investigation, detailed investigation done by thousands of scholars over 1,000 years. So these are the only two options we have. Taking this second option is basically what is called taqleed. Taqleed is following a school of Sunni Islamic law based on thousands of scholars over thousands of years. And what they did was they researched every issue. It wasn't just like, you know, they sometimes took 3 months out. They looked at all the verses and all the hadith and all the chains and all the asanid and isnad and all the rawis. And then they deliberated, like the Hanafi school had a committee of 40 people every day, morning to night. They did no other job. This was their full-time occupation, from morning till night, all 24 hours sometimes, you know, deliberating, coming to and trying to arrive at a conclusion. And this is the second. This second approach that I take, this is what we call taqleed. This is what we call following a madhab. Right, this is what we call following the madhab. Now there's some other issues here, very important issues. Is that for a non-qualified person, and all of us are non-qualified, we have to follow the school of Sunni Islamic law, because you're not qualified. If someone is qualified themselves, between him and Allah, if he thinks he's qualified, then he's qualified. You know, I'm not going to start arguing with someone and saying, you're not qualified. If someone thinks they're qualified, you and Allah, fine. But someone who wants to follow the school, and thinks I'm not qualified, then I'm not going to start with you. You shouldn't be saying that, no, you are qualified. He said, I'm not qualified, I don't know, no, you are qualified. No, you start abusing your own ijtihad. I'm not qualified. No, you are qualified. You, the one who's qualified, fine, you're qualified. The one who says I'm not qualified, let him say that I'm not qualified and let him follow the school. Right? Why do we enforce on someone who thinks that I'm not qualified enough to become a mujtahid? Because a man or a woman, a Muslim, is either a mujtahid or a muqallid. Either you're a qualified person or you're not qualified. If you're unqualified, then you follow. If you're qualified, then you don't have to follow a particular school. Right? There's only. And taqleed, everybody has to do taqleed in this day and age. Because you're either doing taqleed of. Look, I'll tell you one thing here. Even those who don't say that, who say that we don't do taqleed, it's a lie. Every Muslim is doing taqleed. Either of Imam Malik school, Imam Shafi'i school, Imam Ahmed school, Imam Abu Hanifa school, or some scholar of today. Or Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, or Shaykh Uthaymeen, or Shaykh Ibn Baz, or some Saudi scholar, but you are following someone. So you have to follow. Even if you start, you know, one person came to one of my Shaykh and he said, I don't do taqleed. So, okay. And this particular issue, you pray like this, or you do wudu like this. The hadith is weak. You know, it's a verse, hadith is weak. Okay, brother, who told you? How do you know it's weak? in the chain of transmission, the such and such a rawi, the narrator of hadith, he was unreliable. How do you know? Did you meet him? Did you go and see him? When was he? In the 3rd, 4th century? Did you meet him yesterday? Who told you? Shaykh, it's written, Ibn Hajar Asqalani in his books. What are you doing? Taqeed of Ibn Hajar Asqalani. That's what you're doing. You're following the person who's telling you he's weak. So the Shaykh said, Imam Abu Hanifa told me he's not weak. Imam Abu Hanifa, he's saying he's not weak. So you're following Ibn Hajar Asqalani. Fine, Taqeed of Ibn Hajar and doing Taqeed of Imam Malik. Everybody's doing Taqeed of someone. Because you can't meet people right now. We're so far away. We can't decide, we can't see with our own eyes. Everybody has to follow. You will follow by looking in the books. You will say, this person has said this hadith is weak. Someone says, Imam Malik said hadith is not weak, or it's weak. So everybody has to follow. And also, another point here, is that, look, what do you do when you present it with a hadith that is contrary to the school of fiqh states? This is a very solid, very common question. I'll give you an example. I'm not a doctor. Are you a doctor? Dr. Madhab? Who's a doctor right now? Already? Okay. Anyway, potentially you're a doctor. I'm ill. I'm sick. You're a qualified doctor. I'm not a qualified doctor. Right? I come to you. I've got this problem. My neck's hurting. Yesterday my neck was hurting. I've got a problem. It's itching on my skin. I've got this rash on my skin. I don't know what it is, and something's happening, or I've got a spot here or something. I want somebody, you look at me, you do all the tests and everything. And then you say, yeah, I've understood what it is. You need some antibiotics, and you need some cream and some stuff, and you write a prescription. I say, Jazakallah, Dr. Saab. By the way, people must be wondering what he says. The Saab is an Urdu word. I normally tell people, sorry, I forgot to tell you, I should have told you privately, but when you introduce, better because we have different people, there are people who don't know Urdu and things like that, so it's better to avoid some of the Urdu terms and just use the Arabic terms which everybody understands, or English, or... But anyway, not a problem, don't worry. For next time. The doctor said to me that here's a prescription. I took a prescription. Went in my car, straight driving. You know where? Library. Straight to the library. Where's the medical science department today? Check, medicine. Hey, no, doctor made a mistake. The book is saying something else, and this is saying something else. It doesn't make sense to me. Right? It doesn't make sense to me. Yeah? Do I follow what the doctor says, or do I follow what the book says? What do I do? The doctor is a qualified doctor. I know for a fact he's qualified. Do I follow? If I am a doctor myself, then I'll object. Then I have full right. Doctor, you made a mistake. I can argue with you because I'm a doctor. Or at least I have some, I'm half a doctor, not like half a doctor, but I have some good understanding of medicine. I'm studying to be a medic. So I know a lot of things. Then I can have a debate I can question you. If I have no understanding of medicine, then it's absolutely ridiculous for me to start questioning and just by looking at what the book has said, because I don't know, I don't understand. That's just one book. I read all the books and there's context for everything. That's exactly like someone picks up a hadith and sees that it's going contradictory. And I'll give you an Islamic example. This person came to a sheikh, and there was a person there, and he asked a question. He said, you know what, my wudu, how does the wudu break? You know ablution wudu? Wudu. So somebody asked, he said, look, if I pass air and wave gas, does it wudu break? He says, yeah, it's definitely, even if you don't hear or sound or anything, yeah, it breaks. There was a brother there sitting there, near next to the shah, who thought was qualified, but he wasn't qualified. Yeah? Some people who think they're qualified, they think they're mujtahid, but he wasn't. He said, Shah, what are you saying? He said, repeat it. He said, if you pass gas and air and wind, even if you don't hear a sound, the wudu breaks. He said, I don't think so. He said, what? He said, hadith. I read the hadith myself. There's a hadith in the sunnah, and this is a hadith. Yeah, clear. You can pick up sunnah Abu Dawud. I can show you my iPhone right now. I've got the whole 6 books on this. There's a hadith in the Sunnah of Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah ta'ala. La wudu'a illa min sawtin aw rihin. Your wudu does not break if you don't hear a sound or if you don't smell. If you pass gas, but you couldn't hear or you try to smell, you couldn't smell. The hadith, literally, that's what the hadith is saying. You know what the hadith is saying? If you pass gas and wind, or we say, you know, you fart. That's the English term. لا وضوء إلا من صوت أو ريح. Sound or, because either or, normally it's either the sound or the smell. You know? It's either one. If there's a loud sound, normally you don't have the smell. And if it's silent, they say in English, silent, they're deadly. But anyway, that, this is what the hadith said. He said it's a sound hadith. And I checked it, the Imam said it was hadithun hasan. And it was. It is a sound hadith. It is a sound hadith. The chef said, yeah, yeah, definitely, this hadith is sound. He said, then what did you say to him? He said, are you still saying it doesn't break? Your wudu breaks. He said, yes. So what about this hadith? What are you going to do? He said, the Shaykh explained to me, brother, look, you need to understand. There's a context behind this hadith. Look at the other versions of this hadith. Go into the background of this hadith. Check all the detailed commentary on all the different variations. And then he showed him another report from another book of the same hadith of the incident that took place. A man who had the disease of obsessive compulsive disorder, OCD. Yeah? Who came to the Messenger, he kept to the Messenger of Allah. I think I broke the wudu. I think I passed away. I feel like I think I passed gas. He said it so many times, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to me, you know, for you, like people who are in OCD, you have need talent in fact. For you, if you don't hear anything, if you don't smell anything, your wudu is not broken. But that's for you. You know, like some people, this one guy, you know, came to me, so he thinks every day he's dreaming about divorce. He thinks he divorced his wife like 20 times a day. OCD. I tell him, for you, the rules of divorce don't apply. Just go home. Okay, that doesn't mean that it doesn't apply. It does apply. But he told him so emphatically, that, which means that you have to have yaqeen. If your, that your wudu will not break unless you have yaqeen. You're 100% sure. But if you are sure that you passed, you're 100% sure you passed gas and air and wind, but you didn't smell or you didn't hear, your wudu is still broken. It's still broke. Everybody, there's no Muslim who doesn't say that. It's still broken. Do you understand my point? It's still broken. Otherwise, someone whose nose is blocked and our ears are blocked, his wudu will never break. If you have a flu and you've got blocked ears as well, your wudu is not going to break for 2 days. Otherwise, that would happen. The meaning of the hadith is that you have to be sure. If you're sure, even though you can't smell, even though you can't hear, but you're sure, then you're 100% about it, you're all over it. He explained to me, he said, oh, astaghfirullah, for the past 20 years I've been acting upon this hadith, which I picked up a translation in the library and read it. And 20 years, I'm sure I passed, but I always try to hear, sometimes ask my friends, do you hear anything? No. He's not to know a lot of that. You understand the point? This is basically the example of a person who picks up a hadith and tries to act upon it himself. He's not qualified, we are not qualified to pick up hadiths ourselves and act upon them. Okay? Final point of this is that there are certain people in the world who are not absolute mujtahids, but they are quite qualified. They spend like 30, 40 years of their life studying, researching, major scholars of the world. Right? There are great scholars of the world. There are certain people, not too many. We're not going to say to everybody that everybody has to be blindfoldedly, you know, because remember the objective is not to follow a school. The objective, that's why I tell a lot of people in a lot of talks I said, don't say I follow a school. You know, someone comes, if somebody's following a school, a brother came to me and says, I follow the Hanafi school. Says, some of my friends say, do you follow a school? Or do you follow the Messenger of Allah? It's a funny question. Are you Norwegian? Are you Muslim? Where are you? Are you Muslim or are you Norwegian? Where are you? Exactly. Do you follow the Quran Sunnah or do you follow Hanafi school? Same question. I said to him, if he says to you, saying, are you British or are you Muslim? Well, are you? You know, are you Pakistani or are you Muslim? Well, are you? You're both at the same time. So, a lot of people, I said to him, don't say, I follow the Hanafi school. Don't say that. I follow the Maliki school. Don't say, I'm a follower of the Shafi'i school. You know what you say? I follow the Quran and Sunnah, as explained by the Hadith school. I follow the Quran and Sunnah, as interpreted by the Maliki school. I follow the Quran and Sunnah, as explained by the Hanbali school. Basically, that's what it is. I've got a lecture coming up next month in a city in England, Birmingham. The title I chose myself, I told the organizers, this is the title. I wrote it as well. You know, this is actually the talk that's going to happen, inshallah, on the 1st of January, basically. And we look at this point, because it's a very important point, because we have some problems in England as well. I told them, I said, look, this is what you should have the title. The Hanafi Madhab and the Quran and Sunnah. That's basically the title of the talk. Then, bullet points. What is a Madhab? Is following a Madhab not following the Quran and Sunnah? Was Imam Abu Hanifa really weak in Hadith? What is the juristic methodology of the Hanafi school? Was the Hanafi school derived from the Quran and Sunnah? How was the Hanafi school derived from the Quran and Sunnah? Because it is based on the Quran and Sunnah. We are only following a school because it's based on the Quran and Sunnah. If Hanafi school, if I found out today that it's based on the Torah, I'll leave it today. If I found out the Maliki school was based on the Zabur or Injil or some other book here, I would leave it today. The only reason is I have confidence and trust in these thousands of scholars that they have deduced, extracted correct rulings from the Quran and Sunnah, which I want to follow. I want to follow Quran and Sunnah and nothing else, but rather than, you know, do my own job and think I'm qualified, I trust certain people, not certain, hundreds of people, thousands of people, I rely on them, and I just follow them, as they've explained and they've interpreted the Quran and Sunnah. Anyway, these are just some short, brief answers. This topic can go on and on and on, but I'm just going to end it because we have lots of questions.